Light is measured in stop numbers. Aperture is measured in f-stops. Shutter speed. Hi, this is Omar and you're watching Shutterology. In this video, we are going to talk about how shutter speed, ISO and aperture affect the exposure, which is also the luminance in the scene. So the exposure, as you know, is made up of stop numbers. These stop numbers range from -5 to +5 in the camera, or it can be -3 to +3, depending on the camera you have. You're using a basic Canon camera. So in our camera, it shows only until -3 and +3. The basic idea behind these three is that you use these exposure, ISO, and shutter speed to get the amount of light in a picture you want. It's as simple as that. At first, it could be intimidating or difficult to understand, but it's really not. I mean, all you're doing is manipulating one or the other to get the picture you want, to get the amount of brightness you want in a picture. Aperture is made up of aperture blades in front of a lens. It's the same concept we have in our eyes. It goes small and big, depending on if you want less light or more light. In a lens, we have aperture blades, which are in the middle of the lens elements. You can control it from the camera and let as much or as less light in as we want. So shutter speed. Shutter speed is the speed in which a shutter closes and opens every second. A shutter are blinds in front of a camera sensor, and you can have a fast shutter speed, which would let less light in, or a slower shutter speed to let more light in. Shutter speed, which is the speed at which a shutter opens and closes at. ISO. ISO is the sensitivity of the camera sensor or film to the light. So if you have ISO cranked up high, what that does is it'll make the sensor more sensitive to light, so the picture would be brighter. If you have ISO all the way down to, let's say, 100, which is mostly in most cameras the smallest you can go or the least amount you can go, the image or the photo would be darker as compared to ISO 1600. Aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. These are the three tools we use to control the light in the photo. So again, the light in the photo is measured in stops, and we see it in exposure compensation, which is displayed in a camera. A good way of thinking about these three is, let's say you have a bucket and you have a tap on top of the bucket and you have water flowing in from the tap. So when the tap is closed, there's zero water in the bucket. And when you open the tap, what happens is water starts coming in from the faucet, falls down the bucket, and then you close the tap again. So the amount of time you had that tap open for is your shutter speed. So if you have the tap opened in for longer, you have more water in the bucket. That means you have more light in the picture. It's the same concept. Now with aperture. So aperture is this, if we take the same example of the faucet and the bucket, so aperture would be the opening of the tap itself. So if you use a bigger tap and open the tap for the same amount of time, you will have more water for that same amount of time. If you have a more smaller tap, you open the tap for the same amount of time, you're going to have less water in the bucket. So that's how we see aperture. It's the opening where the light comes in from, or in this analogy, water. So for ISO, let's say you have something blocking the tap, a filter perhaps. If your filter is a coarse filter, if you open the tap for the same amount of time, you'll have more water in the bucket. If the filter is very fine, it's a very fine mesh, you'll have less water in the bucket. So that the ISO is something in front of a sensor. So as we saw by the help of this water faucet bucket analogy, it's not that hard to understand these three concepts. It's basically light gathering in the camera, and you have these three ways to adjust that. Now the question comes that why would we use three ways to do the same thing, right? Well, each of these three have a pro and a con, or pros and cons to each method. Before we get into that, let's talk about luminance or exposure itself. Again, exposure is measured in stop numbers. So the stop numbers are the amount of light which is present in that exposure slot. For example, in a bucket example, if we open the water for a specific amount of time, you have a specific amount of water in the bucket, let's say a liter of water. So that 1 liter can be thought of as one exposure unit or exposure stop. That's how we think of light in stops. Now let's talk about aperture first. As we discussed earlier, there's pros and cons of using each setting to do the same thing, which is the normal amount of light in a shot so that the shot is properly exposed. With aperture, what you're doing is you're opening the lens up to let the maximum amount of light in. Aperture is measured in F numbers or F stops. The F stops go from F1.2 to F1.8 to F2 to F2.8, F4, F5.6, F6.3. So these are F numbers in which aperture is measured in. The stops of light we talked about before. With aperture, going from, let's say, F2.8 to F4 is one stop of light. Going from F2 to 2.8 is again one stop of light. So that's one unit of exposure compensation you would see in your camera as a meter, going from 0 to 1 to 3, or going from 0 to minus 1, minus 2, and minus 3. So with aperture, keep this in mind, that if your photo is underexposed by minus 1, you would just turn up the aperture one stop higher to get the image properly exposed. So now, if this is this simple, why do we use the other settings? Well, like we discussed, there are pros and cons, and there's also physical limitations on the lens itself. For example, the lens you're shooting with, the minimum it goes in terms of F number, or the maximum in terms of letting the light in or the opening, is F2.8. And that's the maximum amount it would open to. If we need more light, we would need to utilize the others to recompensate. The other thing is the physical aspect of the lens. If you want bigger opening, obviously you're going to need a bigger lens. And a bigger lens is the heavier lens. And most zoom lenses are heavier in itself. And if you want a low aperture number or a higher opening or a higher, bigger aperture lens, it'll be even bigger. It comes down to carrying the lens. It comes down to ergonomics. It also comes down to expensive lenses. The price goes up really fast. With the aperture, those are the limitations we have. So we have to play within those limitations and get the reasonable amount of aperture lens with a reasonable amount of money, which is easier to carry depending on what photography you're doing. So those are the things we need to consider. Another pro which a lot of people look when they're buying a bigger aperture or a smaller aperture number lens is depth of field, which is that bokeh or a blurry background we get when we're taking portraiture. And it's very pleasing to the eye because the human eye sees things in that way. So when we see a photo or a portrait with a good depth of field, we instantly like it. And that's why most people get lenses with a bigger aperture. But the con to that same pro would be, if you're taking group shots, what happens is if you use too low of a F number, you get a group which is big enough, some faces would be blurred out. So again, we need to look at all of these things before we decide on what's good for us in terms of the picture we're getting, the gear we can afford or get or carry around. With aperture, a lot of people get confused about the aperture number. And the fact that the smaller the number, the bigger the lens opening. An easier way to think about this is in terms of fractions. So 1/2 or 1/2 is bigger than 1/3, which is 1/3. So that's an easy way to think about aperture. They're sort of fractions of amount the lens is open towards. So shutter speed, let's talk about shutter speed a little bit more so that we have a more understanding of how shutter speed contributes towards the exposure in a photo. So with shutter speed, if you have the shutter open more and then close it, so you have a shutter open for a longer amount of time in a scene, you will gather more light between the shutter opening and closing in a picture, right? And then your shutter will open and close faster, or is snappy like that. What will happen is you'll get less amount of light in a photo while the shutter was open for that brief amount of time. Why would one have it open for a shorter amount of time or a longer amount of time? Well, the obvious thing would be a blurry photo. So if you have it open for a longer amount of time, what can happen is you would have a photo which is blurred out. You would notice at night, taking a picture with the phone perhaps, that the photo comes a little bit blurry. That's because the phone is trying to open the shutter inside the phone's camera to be gathering as much light as it can. So that results in a shaky picture, right? But sometimes we may want that. For example, we're taking a photo of a car which is passing by. We want like a motion shot of people skating in a skating ring. We want the background to be blurred out. Or sometimes, let's say we don't want that. Say we want to use a snappier shutter or a faster shutter speed to get water droplets being still in the air, perhaps an animal in the water or children playing around in fountains. We want that crisp shot with water frozen in the air or bubbles, right? So he may use shutter speed for purposes other than light gathering. So those are the pros and cons we might face when using a particular setting to gather the least or the most amount of light we can possibly do. So shutter speed is normally measured in fractions of a second. So let's say 1/30, 1/60th of a second, 1/90th. Those are the fractions of a second the shutter speed is measured with. But in night photography, if you have a tripod handy, you're not worried about a shaky picture, you can measure shutter speed in seconds, which is a whole second. So let's say 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, taking shots of the sky or night shots of the sea. It depends. So shutter speed, again, is measured in fractions of a second or a whole second of time where you want the shutter to be open for in between the opening and closing of a shutter. In terms of measurement units or stops, it still has stops, but it's measured a little bit differently. In terms of measuring the shutter speed, so let's say in a photo you need a stop of light more. To get that, what you're going to do is slowing the shutter speed down. So from 1/30, you go to 1/15, which is double the shutter speed slowed down. And if you want the shutter speed to be faster by one stop, or an image to be darker by one stop, what you do is go from 1/30 to 1/60. If you want a second stop, 1/120. If you want a third stop, 1/240, and you go on from there. So with shutter speed, that's how a stop works. With a given shutter speed, just double it or half it to go that extra stop of light or a negative stop of light. So that's how shutter speed works. Let's talk about ISO. And ISO, again, like we discussed, is the sensitivity of the sensor to light. So with ISO in normal cameras, like consumer cameras, the minimum in ISO would be 100. And normally that's what we use outside. And if it's dawn or dusk, if it's less light, cloudy weather, it can be 200 we use. But that's all in the camera. It depends on the scene, etc. But with ISO, let's talk about ISO in terms of what it is actually. So ISO used to be back in the film days, be the sensitivity of the film itself. With film, what happens is you can only get a film with a specific ISO. You can't change ISO of a film in a camera. But with now digital cameras, what we have the advantage is you can change the ISO on the fly. So that's very good. That gives us easy access to making an image brighter or slower if you have the aperture, whatever you want, shutter speed, whatever you like, but then you have less light, what are you gonna do? You have the ISO, you can just turn it up and it'll compensate for it. But like anything else, like shutter speed and aperture, ISO also comes with its pros and cons. With ISO, what happens is if you turn it up too high, what happens, you get grainy and noisy images. You would not get as crisp of an image. And with ISO, we want it to be the last resort in terms of changing the light and image, because we want the less amount of ISO possible so that we can get a more clearer image. That's how I go around with it, that I first start with aperture, shutter speed, then ISO would be the last thing I would fall down to, because the more sensitive you would make a sensor to be, it picks up noise and it makes the image less pleasing to look at in some circumstances. If you're artsy like that, if you want to have a creative shot, some people turn up the ISO on purpose to get that grainy look, but it really depends. Mostly we keep it as low as possible. With ISO measurement, so again, ISO is also measured in stops. With ISO, it's very similar to shutter speed. To have an extra stop of light in an image, with ISO, what we do is double the ISO. So for example, if you're using ISO 100, what you can do is go to ISO 200. That'll be one extra stop of light. ISO 400 would be another stop of light. So ISO 800 would be, again, another stop of light on top of that. When you are using ISO, you double it or half it to get a stop up or a stop down. And that's how ISO works. So wrapping it all up, shutter speed, ISO, and aperture. Shutter speed is measured in fractions of a second. ISO is ISO numbers. Aperture is F numbers. What they do is, these three tools manipulate the light entering into the camera, which is measured in stops. And these are the tools which we have available to us to get the image we want. Each of them, as discussed, has pros and cons, and each of them contribute towards getting the shot we want.